Hello, boys and girls. I'm Flipper55 with Fatfingergaming, and welcome to Fatfingergaming's continued coverage of the 2015 college football season. Today we have an interdivisional matchup, this ACC battle between Florida State and Georgia Tech. Both Florida State and Georgia Tech have their own fate in their own hands. They win out, they get to the ACC title. The problem is only one team can win out because one team is going to have to take a loss. Florida State has a little bit harder of a road ahead, so this is definitely a must-win for Florida State.
Seeing these two teams go head-to-head is going to be a great treat. Thanks for joining us here on the NCAA College Football Pregame Show. Now let's send it out to Brad and Kirk for all the action. We'll see you at the half.
All right, as you can see here, both teams wearing their home, Georgia Tech, not really home uniform. Both team wearing darks. Why? I don't know. Just decided to do it. Maybe we can have some fun and say, you know, Florida State forgot to bring the whites. Just assuming Georgia Tech would be wearing their whites. Anyways, I did say Florida State's got the harder road and more important to them, but might actually be a lie overall. Georgia Tech, without a doubt, has got the hardest schedule of any ACC team. You have your non-conference Notre Dame, Georgia, your in-conference inter-divisional schedule is Clemson and Florida State. You know, arguably the best two teams in the division. That would be the argument before you saw just how good Louisville was. It's a good thing they were near the sideline. So, and then of course they have to take care of their own division, Miami and Virginia Tech. So. Of the ACC, as I said, Georgia Tech has without a doubt the worst schedule. Florida State only has Clemson left. So I'm not quite sure why I thought Florida State had the harder schedule. There's Everett Golson, 25-35, 222 yards, two touchdowns in the win over Louisville. There you go. In Tallahassee, 20-14. Wasn't that great of an offensive performance by either team, but let me tell you something. When you're going up against the deep – oh, my God. Travis Rudolph just shucks about three people out of his way on a nice gain, a little over the middle. Rudolph's been doing a good job the last couple games. Ermin Lane is, without a doubt, Everett Golson's favorite receiver. He's got five receiving touchdowns on the year. Golson overall, almost 1,700 yards passing, 15 touchdowns, 5 interceptions. Not bad for a college quarterback. I mean, definitely good for a college quarterback. But at the same token, you look at it, and you know, in college football, you're going to play those teams that are horrible, and so there should be some padded stats in there. To me, that's not padded stats. To me, that would be. A quarterback who has faced good competition. What I'm trying to say is if I see 15 touchdowns, 5 interceptions, 1,700 yards, I'm going to assume that they never played a bad team, which is not the case. So, you know, that's the kind of stats that I'd expect from, you know, first down, and they've got their eyes on that goal. Pro line. In, you know, professional football, because there's not many. You don't go up against just an absolute horrible team very often. Yes, I know horrible teams make their way into the NFL, but day in, day out, you're playing professionals, and they're normally extremely good teams. Anyways, there's Travis Rudolph again. That actually, I think, is his fourth touchdown on the year. One more touchdown ties him for the lead. receiving touchdowns for the lead against with Ermin Lane.
He splits the uprights with the extra point. Time for an update from the studio.
Don't worry about that Auburn-Arkansas score. And it looks that like one's going to be played out. In fact, actually, when this is posted online on YouTube, you will already be able to scroll back and see who won that game.
Seminoles are right where they want to be early in this one, partner. Well,
so Florida State, first time we got to see him was against Miami. That was a shocking loss in Tallahassee, 34-17. That was when we were feeling the huge effects of home field disadvantage, especially in the rain. I'm not quite sure why that was going on, but it was going on. Next week, they hosted, which was last week, they hosted Louisville, and they had a game that went down to the closing seconds. A great, great battle game. Definitely one of my favorites of the season. In fact, actually, the thing about the Florida State-Louisville game that I absolutely loved, it was the game week one. You know, I contend that Louisville, when the season starts, you guys are going to be shocked at just how good Louisville is. That's what I contend. In this college football, I can see their roster, their digital roster. So I knew Louisville was going to be a good team. So I had already circled the Louisville Florida State game as definitely a game I wanted to see, definitely one of my favorite games that I wanted to see. And I was not disappointed. Very happy with that game. Awesome game. Definitely how I thought it would go down to the last seconds. Definitely a defensive battle. The only thing that has shocked me, though, is... oh, jeez. The only thing that has shocked me is you know, Florida State just does not have that professional defensive line that I have come to expect from Florida State over the last bunch of years. And it's been the norm for Florida State. Florida State has been known to get those professional defensive line. And what I mean by professional defensive line, I'm talking about, we're not talking about big boys who, you know, run the 40 in 7.5. We're talking about like big boys who are like as fast as some of the running backs that, you know, some of the lower teams are gonna send at you. Just absolutely big, strong, fast, and dominating. That's what I'm talking about by the professional line. And when Florida State knows how to recruit these guys. When Florida State's good, you watch their defensive lines. And, not so coincidental, what's happened with Alabama? You want to see how good Alabama is. I'm telling you, look at that defensive line. That defensive line, when there are professionals on that defensive line, remember, not just being paid by the boosters. I'm talking about big, strong, fast. Oh, Golston throws a bad pick. Oh, that might change things around. Florida State comes up with a great fourth down stop, in which it is extremely hard to stop Georgia Tech on fourth and one. I don't care if you're talking about the digital version. I don't care if you're talking about real life. Let me tell you something. If you actually honestly think you can stop Georgia Tech on fourth and one, that it's an easy stop, you're insane. You are seriously insane. I don't care if Georgia Tech isn't a national powerhouse. Of all the teams that you face,
ball on their own 35.
All the teams in the nation, Georgia Tech would probably always be number one in fourth and one conversions. I'm sorry. It just... Anyways, I don't have no idea what I was talking about before Golston threw that interception. Oh, Bama. You look at the defensive line. If they've got those professionals on the defensive line, they're going to be dominant. They're going to win championships. Simple as that. Same way at Florida State. Florida State went through a little bit of a gap of not being able to recruit those professional linemen. I don't know if there's too many other teams that are like that. As far as how dependent they are. How dependent they are with those defensive linemen. I could be wrong. I know a lot of teams up north depend on their linebackers. In fact, actually, Florida.
And once again, they'll come to the line trying to convert on.
I can remember Florida became dominant with their linebackers, even though I don't think many of them got drafted into the NFL, despite the fact that they were big, they were fast, they were mean, they hit hard, and that's sort of the way they flew around. The way they flew around the field was definitely a reason for at least one of the national championships. The national championship they won against Ohio State. Trying to think, I'd have to. I want to look that up now. I think about it. I want to look up the linebackers that were on that Florida State national championship. See if any of them made the NFL.
Welcome back here.
And how they did. Now I think about it. Florida with Urban Meyer. Now I think about it. I should go back on that. Florida, without a doubt, it was their offensive line. Urban Meyer knows how to recruit offensive linemen. Did the same thing with Ohio State, and lo and behold, you know, they won a national championship. They're going to continue winning national championships for that offensive line. I can tell you that right now.
It's first down.
Very hard to repeat. Very hard to repeat.
And he throws it away.
I just think this quarterback's got to do much better.
But they are returning all but one of their offensive linemen. This is the same offensive line that didn't matter which quarterback he threw behind him. They still were able to win the game.
Or take off and run.
So, anyways.
He might have a chance. Nice run there.
It's interesting to go back and figure out just what schemes, what coaches, and you know what teams need to win, because you can win 18 billion different ways in football. Absolutely love it. There's not just one way. Anybody who says, you know, if you're not playing the spread, you're not going to win football games, wrong. I know in the NFL, I love in the NFL. The NFL talks all about how you need these professional, awesome quarterbacks, these elite quarterbacks to win. Dude, Falco win a Super Bowl. Shut up.
North Carolina and
Eli Manning's won a couple Super Bowls. Shut up. He's not an elite quarterback. Shut up. Here's the other thing. They may be top whatever in the NFL, but that's just because the talent. It's not that.
Let's see if he can shake off that pick that he tossed last time.
There is not a top 10 quarterbacks in the NFL. I would say ever, but that might be a lie. For the most part in the NFL, there's always been about 2, 3, maybe 4 like great quarterbacks, and then a big bulk of quarterbacks that will get you by. And then you'll have quarterbacks that will just lose you football games and can't win a game to save their lives. So this whole I've completely befuddled myself. The whole point to this, there is a lot of different ways you can win in football, a lot of different ways, and it does.
Or else his quarterback's going to be pulling turf.
So don't get caught up in this hole. You have to run the spread. You have to have a running quarterback. You have to have an elite quarterback. You have to have whatever. Defense wins championships. Of course, no one freaking says that anymore, even though that is probably one of the more truer things in the NFL. In football overall. I mean, you got to... You know, even the dynasties, like the 49ers, everybody talks about Joe Montana, Jerry Rice, Dwight Clark, yada, 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 Roger Craig. No one really talks about the defense, and that San Francisco defense was nasty. So, anyways, the score at the bottom's not flopping up. But no, next time, I'm not kidding you guys. Next time somebody talks about needing an elite quarterback, just ask them, do you really think Falco is an elite quarterback? Do you think that? I'm trying to get to, oh shit, I can't go to instant replay. Oops, sorry about that. try not to swear.
In order to get
the names back up, I think y'all know this by now. You just gotta go to instant replay, and the names in the scoreboard will come back up.
With one quarter.
It's not like this is a new game or anything. Looks like this is going to be a good tight game.
Might be neck and neck the whole way.
Here we go. That is the thing here with Georgia Tech. Georgia Tech, it's hard for Georgia Tech to come back, but it's hard to pull away from
their own 29-yard line. Second down.
That's the key with Georgia Tech. Pull away from them. After you pull away from them, then you got them. But other than that, you got to pull away from him.
And he stopped behind the line.
As I said before, both these teams actually have their fate in their own hands. They went out. They would actually be heading to the ACC title game. Of course, Georgia Tech still has Virginia Tech and Miami left to play. Georgia Tech, it's going to be unfortunate. Georgia Tech very well could come away with a not that great of a record, like a 7-5, 6-6 record, but because how hard their schedule is, all it would say to you know, all it would say to you is they beat the teams they're supposed to beat. So that is actually a check mark in the good column, guys. You know, if all you do during the season is beat the teams you're supposed to beat, most college football programs will have a decent record. The fullback's out. We're going to see the lineman in there constantly from here on out.
Second down.
And there he is. Oh, God. Nice. Rumbling, stumbling, fumbling. Well, we hope not the last. Anyways, I've talked throughout the first half. That's what happens when you get me going on these stupid things that people say that you're supposed to just believe. Georgia Tech is actually going to be driving down. They may actually tie this game. I may actually stick on them, just stick around to see if they tie the game. Well, you stick on the mic. I do watch every single one of these games. Justin Thomas with a nice run there. It's going to be second and one. And much like I talked about with the fourth and one, the nice thing about Georgia Tech, they will shock you, though. You know, once every 10 plays, they will shock you. The nice thing about second and one with Georgia Tech is you don't have to be afraid of, like, a super huge play. Then again, there's the touchdown. That's their normal play. I'm talking about the one where the I'll just go with the safety yelling, "Oh, shucks," as the dude comes up to make a big hit on the running back and realizes, nope, the quarterback's got it. The dude's behind you, and your quarterback has been beat. I can remember those plays. In fact, actually, it wasn't normally the run. I didn't fall for the play action too much because as far as the run was concerned, I wasn't that aggressive on the run. If I were to hit the running back, it normally was a good 5 yards, you know, past the line of scrimmage. It was rare. The only time that I come up and make a stick inside that, and there has been plays by that, is just, you know, the parting of the Red Sea. Anybody who played safety or linebacker has seen this before, in which your line, if you're safety, it'd be your line and your middle linebacker just get absolutely decimated. And, you know, Moses just parts the Red Sea, and you can actually physically see into the backfield clear as day. The quarterback put the ball in the running back's hands. And I've seen that most of the time it happened on trap plays. You know, I've seen that. That's the only time that I came up that close to hit the running back, is just that huge parting of the Red Sea, and just being able to visualize it. You know, if I saw it, obviously it was all right, I'd rather come meet him than him come meet me. So you just, you know, full speed ahead, try to make that hit in the hole.
First down.
But most of my, in fact, actually, I don't know if I ever got burned on a play action. When I say burned on a play action, I would say went flat-footed or took a step up. Unfortunately, I have been beat on pass plays. Regardless if I knew it was a pass play or not, it happens. It wasn't the play action that normally got me. Normally, what got me was you run a tight end in front of my face. You throw to him. The second time you run a tight end in my face, I completely obliterate the dude or a wide receiver just because I love protecting the middle. Absolutely love protecting my face. You know, it's one of those things. You come over the middle in front of me. I took it as a insult that you didn't think I could hit. So I came, so I'd come up, make sure to get the hit. I think the coaches who watched tape realized what was going on and said, let's do that. Let's run a dude in front of his face, and then let's run a dude behind him. And that's where I'd get the aw shucks play. Anyways, and we're talking about real life here. We're not talking about NCAA. The video game. I get caught all the time on play action passes. I think just the mere. I think on 3rd and 17, you could run a play action pass, and I would jump. I would jump all over trying to come up and hit the run. It's got the same kind of. I got the same kind of mentality as a dude crossing my face in football. It's just I want to come up and just absolutely destroy the running back in NCAA. Anyways, that's enough of me talking away. Oh, Golson's going to go down 3rd and 18. Uh-oh. We may have a tie ball game here. Now, Florida State does get the ball to start off the second half, so... that's good for the Seminoles. The Seminoles do not want to, you know, if Florida State were to drop this game, that would then turn Louisville back into the leader in the division, and Louisville losing the game, I don't know if it's going to happen. I mean, I was shocked that Louisville lost to Florida State. So Georgia Tech completes this upset, which is possible. Georgia Tech's a good team, consistent. You're not going to catch them on a, you know, you're not going to catch them on a bad game. That's sort of the thing when you run the ball as much as Georgia Tech does. You're definitely not going to catch them on a bad day. And actually, there's Justin Thomas actually throwing the ball. I have no idea his passing stats. It is low. Anyways, it looks like I have to go. I'm trying to get these games in. I got a little bit of a scheduling conflict this weekend, so I'm trying to get these games in. And if you heard my little boy wants something from me, so I'm going to stop playing. I'm gonna go figure out what he wants and have some fun, yada yada yada. I still will pay attention to this game. Looks like it's gonna be a good game. I hope you guys are enjoying the season. Hope you guys are enjoying this game. I hope you guys come join me most Mondays and Thursdays. This Monday I'm actually gonna have a little bit of a actually, you know what, by the time this one comes out, the Monday will be gone, so forget that. Most Mondays and Thursday, come join me on Twitch, 8:45 kickoff. After the football season starts, we're gonna go Monday and Wednesday. But besides that, I'm going to turn it over. Nice 14-14 game. This is going to probably be a good game. Stick around for the second half. I will now go have fun with my boy. Y'all have fun as well.
Doesn't look like he's going to have much time to get rid of this punt. And down he goes at the 46-yard line. Return for a gain of 13 yards. This is the point in the game where you don't want to make any mistakes that give the other guys a reason to feel more confident going into halftime. Tackle at the 35-yard line. Florida State will take their second time out of the half. So they decide to bring the kicker out to try to get 3 points before the half ends. It has the distance. And he splits the uprights. Let's check in with Reese Davis in the studio.
The Tar Heels and Cavaliers have been fighting it for a long time. The South's oldest rival.
All right, Reese and David, thanks, guys. Second half action just about ready to start here. And he got all of this one. Great kick.
Tackle at the 20-yard line.
Kickoff returns 20 yards.
So they're just about set to get the game going again.
Florida State is up by three.
Ready, right,
oh. Brought down after a nice run up the middle.
Good for a game.
So it's second down now, and they need about 4 yards to pick up the first.
They're running it. Hot set. Texas. Motion, motion. Hot.
He gets hit out of bounds at the 27-yard line.
It's a good surge by the defense. They really disrupted the timing on that play and gave them no chance to get the first.
Beatty is waiting for the snap. It's away, and it's a booming punt. Thorne fields it at the 27. He makes it out to maybe the 43-yard line. There's still plenty of time to keep running their offense as usual here. I don't think they need to feel any anxiety about trailing. Tackle made around the 41-yard line.
Loss of 2 yards on the play. That'll bring up second and 12.
From their own 41-yard line, second down. He gets out to about the 42-yard line.
Gain of one on the play.
You don't want that?
That makes it third and 11.
What great concentration. He left his feet, made the catch, and managed to secure it when he hit the ground. That was just sensational.
It's first and 10. Ball on the 45-yard line. Gets out to around the 35.
That's a gain of 10 on the play. That brings up second and 1.
And he's tackled after positive yardage.
First down.
From the 30-yard line, it's first down. He makes it out to maybe the 29-yard line.
That's good for a gain of 1 yard. That brings up second and 9.
Here's an opening. Gains his way to the 16-yard line. From the 16-yard line. First down. And he's taken down right around the 6-yard line.
Gain of 10 on the play. That brings up second and 1.
We're at play number 9 of this current drive.
Mike 5. Ready. Red 18. Red 18. Hot, hot.
He's tackled at the 6. Maybe a yard on the run by the tailback.
That'll bring up 3rd and inches.
And so it's another 3rd down upcoming here.
There's nothing better than having an athletic, versatile, and instinctive safety.
He makes a big-time play here with his recognition of the run, comes up and does what he does best, which is making a nice, sure tackle on the ball carrier.
Georgia Tech is down three and looking to tie it up, and it's good. Looks like they're ready for the kick. Excellent kick. This one's going to be down in the end zone for a touchback. You don't want to squander any possessions, but maybe now's the right time to dip into your bag of tricks a little. Think about some gadget plays to catch the defense napping. Quick throw out to the receiver. He's to the 40. And he's tackled at the 49.
That's good for a gain of 26 yards. That makes it first and 10.
First and 10. Ball on the 49. Here he goes. And he hits him hard at the 38-yard line.
That's a gain of 11 on the play. First down.
Tackled after decent pickup.
That's a gain of 4 on the play. That brings up 2nd and 5.
From the 34-yard line, it's 2nd down. Goes right, picked off. And that's the 2nd interception of the game by this defense.
These guys are all over the field. It seems like wherever the quarterback throws the ball, there's a defender sitting right there.
They'll drop him for a loss.
Loss of 1 yard on the play. That'll bring up 2nd and 11.
It's 2nd down and 11 to go. Ball on the 14.
Mike 5. Come on. Come on, D. Ready.
Pitches back. He's knocked out of bounds at the 28-yard line. They're trying to stop the run here with a goal line defense. Lateral's back. He's to the 40. He finally goes down at the 31-yard line.
That makes it 1st and 10.
Let's see now how the defense responds to giving up the gain on the run. Stop at the 20.
First down.
Gets out to around the 9.
That makes it 1st and goal.
First down, and they've got their eyes on that goal line. To pitch it, and now the ball is loose, and it's scooped up by the running back. And this is the 8th play of the drive.
You're not ready. You're not ready.
Mike 5. Mike 5.
Ready.
Pitches, and he's got room. Touchdown, Tech.
It shouldn't have surprised these guys to see the run coming at them, but they just couldn't stop it.
That is a clutch touchdown. Tie game, and they find a way to put it in for 6. I know there's a lot of time left, but that was a big one.
He makes the PAT. The kicker looks like he's ready to kick this one off. He's to the 20. He's taken down at the 21-yard line. Their last drive ended with an interception. We're about to find out what the defense can do this time.
Each possession gets more and more vital as the game goes on, especially when you're behind. You can't afford to make many more mistakes.
Setting up the play action. And he's immediately tackled.
Smith on the tackle at the 38-yard line. First down.
First down, 10 to go. Ball on the 38.
Set. Oklahoma!
Just throws this one away.
Even though they didn't sack him, the pressure was still enough to force a bad pass. If you can get in there and disrupt the pocket, then the quarterback is going to have a tougher time getting the ball to his playmakers.
Down! Hey!
Zips it out, and it's the tight end again. Tackled for a loss.
That is a loss of 2 yards.
Great game so far, and it looks like it'll be decided in the fourth. 24-17, Georgia Tech. Third and long. This defense digs in here, and it could be their ball game. Fires it out. Well, they've got the lead, and they come up with a big stop, and it looks like they're going to get the football back. The man defense proves to be too tough against the screen.
That was an excellent job by the defenders. They fought off their blocks and found the ball before the play had a chance to develop.
80 awaits the snap. He's tackled at the 25. Florida State's really excited to watch this guy grow with this defense. That was his first tackle, but I guarantee you, he's got hundreds more coming.
This is a pretty crucial series right here. With things being so tight, your best players have to step it up on both sides of the ball.
Georgia Tech is up 7. He's taken down around the 28-yard line.
Gain of 3 on the play. That'll make it 2nd and 7.
It's 2nd down, 7 to go. Ball on the 28-yard line. They'll bring him down at the 27.
That's what I'm talking about, baby.
Loss of 1 on the play. That'll bring up 3rd and 8.
Tackled right away.
I like the call here by the defense to bring the heat with the outside linebacker. It was just a better call by the offense, and that's why it's a 1st down.
1st and 10. Ball on their own 38. Nice run, and he's brought down. Around the 44-yard line.
Gain of 2 yards. That'll bring up 3rd and 4.
And they'll look to convert here on another 3rd down.
So we got man, man, man. Mike 5.
Flushed out, and he's going to get sacked.
Sacks the quarterback.
Nice hit, baby.
Loss of 5 on the play. 4th down.
Whitfield, the return man. He's out to the 30. He gets out to about the 32-yard line. Both teams realize that when the ball is snapped, we're one play away from a very different ball game. Almost intercepted there.
Boy, a golden opportunity missed by the defense. That was a sure interception, only to be dropped.
Second and 10. Ball on the 32-yard line. Quarterback all by himself in the backfield with five wideouts. Gets to around the 42.
Call it a gain of 10 yards. First down.
The sub package in there defensively in this five wide receiver set. Passes left, going the other way.
Mays get the interception.
He steps up and makes a big turnover.
Yeah, he just made a huge play right there. He knew what was coming all along.
We've got a first and 10. Ball on the 39-yard line. Georgia Tech is up by a touchdown. Tackle at the 42.
Call it a gain of 3 yards. That makes it second and 8.
Here we go, D. Get off the field.
My five. Ready. Green.
And he carries the ball for a nice gain.
Call it a gain of 4 yards. That makes it third and 3.
Third down, and they're going to need about 3 yards to pick up the first down. He's pushed out of bounds at the 49-yard line.
Stop your body. Mike five.
He fights forward to about the 46.
That's a gain of 3 on the play. That makes it 2nd and 8.
2nd and 8 coming up here. Ball on the 46-yard line. He fights forward to about the 43.
That's good for a gain of 3 yards. Third down.
Come on, baby. Let's see what you got.
My five.
Wide 50. Check. Regular.
Drill at the 31. First down, 10 yards to go. Ball on the 31-yard line. Just under 3 to go in regulation. Gets out to about the 21-yard line. Florida State will take their first time out of the half. It's the 9th play of the drive. And they get nice yardage on that run.
The big fella's a load to bring down, so when he gets a little bit of room, he can do some damage.
First and 10. Ball on the 15-yard line. The 10. And he shoved out of bounds at about the 5-yard line. The Seminoles using their third and final timeout. This is the 11th play of this drive. Through a defender, and he's in. He splits the uprights with the extra point. Reese Davis is standing by with this update. Reese. They line up to kick this one away. Sends it sailing downfield.
He's to the 20. And down he goes at the 21.
Quarterback couldn't maintain possession on their last drive. Let's see what he does here.
So much in football is about how you respond to adversity. Moving forward after a turnover is a perfect example of that.
And he just gets rid of it.
Second down, 10 yards to go. Ball on the 21-yard line. Just under two to go in the game.
Down! Blue 14! High!
He airs it out. Caught, and he's out of bounds at the 40-yard line. That's a first down as they hooked up on the deep route.
And the defender just got outrun and outplayed by the receiver. He wanted it more, and that allowed him to make a heck of a play.
Down!
Sends it out quick, intercepted. And that interception essentially ends this game. From their own 42-yard line, first down. Now he pitches it, knocked out of bounds at about the 49.
That's good for a gain of 7 yards. That'll bring up second and three.
Tackle made at the 50.
Gain of 1 yard.
It's third down, and they're about 2 yards shy of the sticks.
Four down. Mike five. Let's go.
He makes it out to maybe the 49-yard line.
Gain of 1 on the play. That'll make it 4th and 2.
Let's see if he aims for the sideline and tries to get this thing down deep in their own territory. He gets it away, and this is a really nice punt. This one will go into the end zone, and they'll bring it out to the 20. Nothing left here except to see the clock hit zero. A comeback is just not happening.
Going deep.
Picked off, and that'll seal it up.
He's tackled at the 40.
This should be a kneel down as they just try to kill the clock. You're an offensive coordinator. You love this play. His quarterback will take a knee. And so that's going to do it. Our final score in this one, 31-17, Yellow Jackets.